Well, good morning, everyone. This weekend, I was with faith and community leaders from Spokane and around the country as we walked the steps of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. on a pilgrimage. And together we focused on his vision of unity. Unity meaning wanting the best for each other. And I was reminded that this continues to be a search for a more perfect union where everyone can reach their full potential and pursue their version of the American dream. And that includes women across the country. March is Women's History Month, and we get to celebrate and honor so many trailblazers, so many women that are doing well in our economy and have more opportunities than ever. We have nearly 10 million women-owned businesses in America, nearly 3 million that are owned by women of color. 2 out of 3 businesses are being started by women today. And all of these numbers present a brighter future for women and families all across this country because of the success of the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. We are the faces of tax reform. Tax reform was written with us in mind. I've heard from small business owners that are getting ready to tear out their walls, expand, or start a second location because they can write off the full cost of the equipment. For working moms and dads, we doubled the child tax credit. We preserved the adoption tax credit. We've expanded 529 accounts to help with the cost of raising kids. And for moms like me that have children with disabilities, because of ABLE 2.0, those kids now will have the opportunity to go explore work and see if they can find a full-time job. For millions of moms and women, they're seeing an increased pay increase. At Wheatland Bank in Spokane, all those entry-level workers are seeing pay increases. They can invest more of their own money in their education, retirement, everyday expenses. It was Nancy Reagan who said, "Feminism is the ability to choose what you want to do." And that is exactly what the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act is doing in empowering people all across this country. I'm excited today to have my friend and colleague from Georgia's 6th District, Congresswoman Karen Handel, with us. In her district, the average family of four will see a tax cut of $4,420. And remember, a tax cut is a pay increase. So thank you, Karen, for being here and sharing some more insights.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank you for the chance to be here. You know, in December, we promised the American people that we were going to deliver a tax cuts and jobs bill that was going to deliver economic growth, the likes of which most of us in this room have never experienced and most Americans haven't experienced. Well, those pro-growth policies, the regulatory relief that we've delivered along with these tax cuts are delivering right now on that promise to so many Americans across the country. And in March, as we celebrate Women's History Month, I wanted to talk about a woman in my district who is a real trailblazer. Her name is Nancy Juneau, and she's the CEO of Juneau Construction. She's a 32-year veteran of the construction industry, and she now owns the largest women-owned contractor in Georgia. It is also the largest woman-owned company of any kind in the state of Georgia. And here's what she had to say about the tax cuts and jobs bill. In construction, things are cyclical. So this tax bill passage is going to allow Juneau Construction to increase its bonding capacity. And in general contracting, bonding capacity is everything. And that means Juneau will be able to pursue larger contracts, which means more revenue, which means more jobs that they can create. Growth like this directly affects so many American families, not just in the 6th District, but across the country. There's another individual, Kim. She also happens to work in the construction industry. And when I ran into her recently in my neighborhood, she was so excited to tell me that she is bringing home more than $260 a month in her paycheck. She took the Check Your Check challenge and found over $260 more a month. That is meaningful and real for a single mom making sure that her daughter gets through college. So this is working for Americans. It's working for women. It's working for most working families across this country. And I look forward to seeing even more positive results in the months to come. Thank you very much.
Well, good morning. I was honored to start this morning by addressing APEC's annual convention. And later today, we'll see thousands of people from all across the country going to offices of members of Congress, both House and Senate, to express their strong support for Israel, but also to just reiterate this great relationship that's a very bipartisan relationship and the love between the United States and Israel. And one of the things I shared with them is later on today, our leadership team will be meeting with Prime Minister Netanyahu. When I was in the hospital, literally the day I was shot, Prime Minister Netanyahu personally reached out. And it wasn't until a few days later when I came out of the many surgeries and kind of was finally able to talk that I got word of that. And he had said, when I am able to, he wants to talk to me. So we arranged a call that day. And he was just so warm in his support for me, but it showed just how not only strong the relationship is between the United States and Israel, and we do so much to support them militarily and in the things that they're doing to fight terrorism, to fight Iran's attempt to get a nuclear weapon, and how we support their ability to protect Israel and stand with them. But it shows the love between our two countries and just how strong that bond is. It's a personal relationship built on strength and love, and we really look forward to meeting with the Prime Minister later today to talk further about that bipartisan bond and how we can help advance our causes. I know as we talk about tax reform, there's so many success stories we keep hearing about, and the stories don't end. The list that I keep at MajorityWhip.gov that started with AT&T announcing $1,000 bonuses to over 200,000 workers is now more than 400 companies listed at MajorityWhip.gov that have announced pay raises and bonuses for their workers. This means real money in the pockets of hardworking families. And just think about this. When we started this, when we said we're going to actually work on a bill to reform our tax code, simplify it, but cut taxes at every level so that families that are struggling can have more money in their pockets. It unfortunately became a partisan fight. You saw the Democrat leadership criticizing the ability for people to get more money in their pockets. And they started talking in front of cameras about tax cuts for the rich. Well, just think about the headlines last week. Last week, the headline in the AP said, Democrats seek to help wealthy in response to tax changes. Imagine that. As they're publicly talking and decrying the rich, our tax cuts are actually helping hardworking middle-class families, and Democrat leaders are trying to now make changes to help the wealthy in this endeavor. So it just goes to show you, we focused on making sure we could rebuild our middle class. We want to put more money in the pockets of families, and look at the results. Numbers are coming out. U.S. jobless claims fell to the lowest level since 1969. That's how tax cuts are working to help families and people that had just given up on the workforce, given up on trying to find a job because the economy was so bad. Now they're actually getting back into the workforce and becoming part of the American dream because of what we did. And finally, we're seeing small businesses expanding at the fastest pace since 2004, manufacturing coming back to America. So it's great to see tax cuts working. I know that the leader's going to be talking about the Rutherford bill. I'm proud to be a co-sponsor of that bill, which actually focuses on increasing school safety, something that we are working on in a bipartisan way. But again, the leader's going to talk more about that. A good week. Look forward to seeing our friends from APAC here on the Hill.
Good morning. I know you've got a lot going on in the media, but I want to focus you maybe on what's actually happening in the House and in this week. Our priority is to make sure we build America stronger, not just this year, but next year and decades to come. That means strengthening our physical and digital infrastructure. So today on the floor in the House, we'll vote on the Raybom Act. This will reauthorize the FCC for the first time in 28 years. This incredible bipartisan bill will increase oversight, it'll introduce reforms, and more importantly, it'll help us get to 5G. It will expand high-speed internet abilities, and also this week today you'll have Transportation Secretary Elaine Chao will testify before the Transportation Infrastructure Committee on the President's infrastructure proposal. That's what's happening this week, but I want to announce also what we're going to do next week. You all know Sheriff Rutherford, former sheriff of Jacksonville. He has a bill, Stop School Violence Act, This is Student Teachers Officers Preventing School Violence. We will have that bill up on the floor next week. That will add to, along with the Fix NICS bill that we have sitting over in the Senate. We'll also have the FBI up here talking to oversight and judiciary on where the failures happened and why, to make sure we could have those corrections so that could never repeat itself again. As many of the members have talked about, we've all been out through our districts, and the one challenge we want to make to all Americans is check your check. Just check your check to see what has transpired with the tax reform bill, that you will actually have more money in your paycheck. I had an individual tell me this week that that little extra between he and his wife made the difference that they were able to go out and purchase the car. I was out in the oil fields. Individuals worked there a number of years, came back and said, made a fundamental difference in the week to week, and make sure to tell those back in D.C. that these are not crumbs when it comes to the families to make a difference. So for all those across America, this is only the beginning of America's comeback, and we will finish the job by the infrastructure and the other parts that we are doing across the country to make sure America is not only growing economically, but is safe as well.
You know, I must say, it's great to see all the media interest in the success of tax reform. Speaking of which, we had some really great news last week, spurred on by the new tax reform law. For starters, new data revealed that consumer confidence hit a 17-year high last week. People are optimistic about the future, which encourages more spending, more investment. It's a sign of a healthy, growing economy. Second of all, Labor Department reported that jobless claims in the United States, the number of people filing for unemployment, dropped to its lowest level in almost five decades. Think about that for a second. We saw just last week the number of people filing for unemployment rate for unemployment going to the lowest level in 49 years. People are getting work. Companies are hiring more workers. This is very, very important. Also, U.S. manufacturing is expanding at the fastest rate in nearly 14 years. These are all very encouraging numbers, and it's undeniable that real people are being helped by the personal tax cuts in the Tax Cut and Jobs Act. To top it all off, two more major companies, Carter's and Mission Produce, announced it would pass along the benefits of tax reform to its workers. Thanks in large part to the bonuses given by hundreds of companies due to tax reform, the Bureau of Economic Analysis estimated that Americans took home an increase of $30 billion alone in January. The agency also estimated that the law reduced personal taxes in January by a rate of $115 billion per year. That's huge. That is more evidence that paychecks are growing, that take-home pay is bigger, that workers have more for their families. One thing that I gotta say hasn't gotten a whole lot of attention, it's the fact that this law doubles the per-child tax credit to $2,000 per child. That means moms and dads, often people who need this relief the most, are gonna be helped in a really big way. Take Andy Mateague in New Jersey. He told the Asbury Park Press that he's gonna put this extra money because of the $2,000 per child tax credit that he now gets in his paycheck toward his kids' college tuitions. So this tax reform law is really making a positive difference in people's lives. That's why we're here, to make a difference in people's lives. What we're seeing is it's helping families save for college, it's helping families put money away, it's putting more money in people's pockets, and it's also expanding economic growth to the point where unemployment is now at a 49-year low. That is exactly what we were hoping to achieve when we passed this law, and we're very excited to see those results materialize. Any questions?
Tax related. Mr. Speaker, could you comment on the tariff announcement from the President? What have you spoken to him regarding that, and are you hopeful that he'll pull it back?
Yeah, so that's fairly broad. Let me say it this way. There is clearly abuse occurring. Clearly there is overcapacity, dumping, and transshipping of steel and aluminum by some countries, particularly China. But I think the smarter way to go is to make it more surgical and more targeted. So I think 232 is a little too broad, and I think it's more prone to retaliation. And so what we're encouraging the administration to do is to focus on what is clearly a legitimate problem and to be more surgical in its approach so that we can go after the true abusers without creating any kind of unintended consequences or collateral damage. I'm sorry, we don't do the blurred out thing. Anna.
Yesterday when you said through your spokeswoman that you're
honestly, I'm not watching the gyrations of the market. What we're trying to do is make sure we have good economic policy. And just to repeat what I said, we think the smart approach, the best approach, and the president's right to point out that there are abuses. There clearly is dumping and transshipping of steel and aluminum. That's absolutely happening. There's a big overcapacity problem. Let's go focus on that. Let's go focus on the abusers of that. And that is why we think that the proper approach is a more surgical approach so that we do not have unintended consequences. That's what we've been encouraging the administration. The person who's running point on us is the Ways and Means Chairman, Kevin Brady. He's been working on some solutions with the administration. Those talks are ongoing, and I'm encouraged that hopefully we can get to a good place. Well, look, we think the economy is doing very well. We want to make sure that every step we take helps the economy. We want to make sure that abusers are held to account, especially China when it comes to dumping and transshipping. But we also want to make sure that every step we take forward does not create any unintended consequences. Look, I'm not going to go into our private conversations. We've had multiple conversations about this. He knows our view. Every now and then, we're just going to have a different approach on how we should tackle these problems. But it should be acknowledged that there is a problem that needs to be addressed here. We just want to make sure that it's done in a prudent way that's more surgical so we can limit unintended consequences. Thank you.
Karen, the way it works.